How are y'all doing today? Today I want to talk on a subject about the description of the kingdom of God, the New Jerusalem, and life in our heavenly home. Yes, there is a kingdom of God that's coming. Jesus Christ told us this. He told us there was a kingdom coming, and that all should repent of their sins, for the time of the kingdom of God is near, is at hand. And today I want to talk to you about just those subjects, about what it's like in the kingdom of God, what we'll do, what kind of activities will we be involved in. I want to talk to you about that. So, let's get started. First of all, turn me to Matthew chapter 3, verse 2. Matthew chapter 3, verse 2. This is what he says. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. Verse 2 says, and saying, repent, ye, for the kingdom of God of heaven is at hand. The kingdom is real. And it will come. It will come physically. You will see it. If you're alive, you will see it come. Mansions are made out of gold. The city is bigger than New York. It's so big, it almost fits in the middle of the United States. It's so big. Streets of gold. In the middle of the downtown, you see a big, huge stream of clear water. It's called the Living Water. And on both sides of the roses, trees. And I'll get to in a little bit to describe description of what the new heaven, the new Jerusalem looks like. First of all, life in the heavenly home. Turn me to Revelation chapter 22:1-5. We'll start that off. Revelation 22:1-5. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. And in the midst of the streets of it And on either side of the river was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manners of fruit and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healings of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, his name shall be in their foreheads, and there shall be no night there. And they need no candle, neither no light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them, and they shall reign forever and ever. When we get to heaven, the lost ones, the ones who didn't make it, and this is going to be surprising to some, would no longer be remembered. Once you enter into kingdom, the ones that you loved and thought that made it won't make it, but you know what? Your memory of them will be wiped away, and they will no longer cease to exist. That's why it says in Malachi 4, 1 through 3, it talks about that the people, the wicked, will burn up into ashes. You can find that in Malachi 4, 1 through 3. It talks about the lost souls, hell and the lake of fire. Matter of fact, Revelation talks about that the hell itself will be cast into the lake of fire. So the lake of fire is this ball of flame that will burn up, and everything, all the elements in it will burn up like a great furnace, including the wicked and the lost. They won't burn forever, but they will turn into ashes, and then they will cease to exist. That's what that word internal forever means. Cease to exist. No more. And so they will, once we're in inner heaven, they will be out of our minds. We won't hardly think about them. They will be cut from the books. They will be taken out of the books of the remembrance without feelings of sorrow. They will be wiped out of our minds. Psalms 9:5. I tell you this one. Psalms 9:5. Thou hast rebuked the heathens, thou hast destroyed the wicked, and thou hast put out their name forever and ever. And say, once they're gone, there's nothing left of them. They will cease to exist. You know, if that word forever, as you find in Revelation 20, means forever to exist, no more existence. Look at Sodom and Gomorrah. They died. They became ashes, but they ceased to exist today. That's what that internal fire forever means. What will we do in heaven? Well, first of all, we will worship God. You can find that in Isaiah 66. For as the new heaven and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your seed with your name remains. And in it, and it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another shall all flesh come to worship before me, says the Lord. And then turn me to Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah 14, verses 16 and 17. And it shall come to pass that every one that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep those feasts of tabernacles. And it shall be that whosoever will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King and the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. Then we will sing and play heavenly music. Isaiah chapter 35. Verse 10. And the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness and sorrow, and sighing shall flee away. And then Isaiah 51:11. Therefore the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing unto Zion. And everlasting joy shall be upon their head, and they shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away. Mourning, sadness, grievousness. Psalms 87:7. Psalms 87. And will the singers as the players on instruments shall be there, and all my springs are in thee. Revelation 14, 2 through 3. Revelation chapter 4. Excuse me. Revelation 14, 2 through 3. And I heard a voice from heaven and the voice of many waters. The word waters in the prophet symbol means people. So that's what you understand that. And I heard a voice from heaven and the voice of many waters. In other words, many people. And as the voice of a great thunder, and I heard a voice of harpers and harping with their harps. And they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders, and no man could learn that song but 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. Number 3, we will enjoy never fading flowers or trees. Nothing will ever fade away. Ezekiel 47:12. Ezekiel 47:12. And I'm reading from the King James Version. And by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaves shall not fade, neither shall the fruits thereof be consumed, and it shall bring forth new fruit according to this his months, because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary, and the fruits thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for medicine. From Isaiah 35 verses 1 and 2. The wilderness and the solitary places shall be glad for them. And the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. How many people have ever gone through a desert and seen it all being dried? Cracked dark growths and thorn bushes and little grass here and there once in a while, so dry that it cracks the ground. That won't be like that no more. It says here in verse Isaiah 35:1, it says, the wilderness and the solitary places shall be glad for them, that the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose, and shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Libyan shall be given to it, the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Isn't it wonderful what heaven's going to be like? We will visit loved ones, prophets, and parches, and etc. Matthew 8:11. And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and from the west, shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. Revelation 7, 9 through 17. And seriously, do you want to miss these activities? Do you really want to live in agony and cease to exist? Do you want to burn up, or do you want to give your heart to God and be saved and be able to enjoy the life, eternal life, and all the things that comes with it? Revelation 7, 9 through 17. And after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. Verse 10 says, and I cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth up on the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood around about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts that fell before the throne of their faces, and worshipped God, saying, amen. Blessed and glory and wisdom be thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. And one of the elders answered, saying to me, What are these which are arrived by white robes, which are in which they came? Which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? Verse 14 says, And I said unto them, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, These are they which come out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. And therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne that shall dwell among them, they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Ain't that wonderful? We will study the animals in heaven. Isaiah 11, 6 through 9. Wolf also shall dwell with a lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with a kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them, and the cows and the bears shall feed their young, and one shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. And the sucking child shall play on the hole of the asp, a snake, ASP. And the winged child shall put his hands on the cockatrice den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountains. For the earth shall be full of knowledge of the Lord of as the waters cover the sea. And 65, Isaiah 65, 25. I mean, isn't it so peaceful? I mean, I was telling God this morning, I gladly give up my sins, all my pleasures of earth, all the sins and wickedness, I gladly give them up. Just to be with God forever and ever. I do. There ain't no sin in this world worth hanging on to miss all the abundance of life. But to be ready, you have to surrender all of your will to God. You have to do away with all your sins, all your pleasures of your own self, pleasures of lust, pleasures of adultery, stealing, lying, cheating, smoking, cussing, whatever it is. You have to give it up. You cannot go to heaven as long as you hang on to sins. It's your choice. You can either hang on to them and die in them and cease to exist no more, or you can give them up and ask God to forgive you of your sins. Turn to him. Get saved. Get right with God. And when he comes back, he'll take you with him. And you will live forever and ever. So which one would you rather? Hang on to something of earthly pleasures? Of the only thing that only lasts temporary that will cause you to get in trouble? And burn in the lake of fire, up to ashes, to cease to exist no more, separation permanent forever from God, or give them up Don't worry about the pleasures of earth or lust of earth. Give them up and be with God for eternity. Which one do you rather have? It's up to you. But me, I give mine up. I give my sins up for a crown. People don't know what they're missing when they hang on to their sins. You have to first of all acknowledge you're a sinner. You have to confess of your sins and confess of your unconfessed sins. An unconfessed sin is a sin that you've held with or hid for years and that you didn't know, want nobody to know. You know, there's no saying that I'll take the secret to my grave. Well, that's a possibility, but it's going to cost you. You have to be willing to confess your unconfessed sins to God. And when you do, He'll have mercy on you and He will forgive you. But you have to be willing to have your sins all washed away. Ask God for repentance. Confess your sins and unconfessed sins. Live right. And change your lifestyle around. God did not come to destroy us, but to give us eternal life. So God, the lake of fire was not meant for human mankind, but it was meant for the devil and his angels. But there's a lot of lost people who wind up going there unless they get right with God. That's why Jesus Christ says you need to repent of your sins, because the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of heaven is at hand. You never know. Don't risk that chance on, and if he doesn't come anytime soon, you could still die in your sins. You could drop dead just like that without even asking forgiveness. And then guess what? You'll be caught in your sins when you die. So, you need to get right with God. If there's something in your life that you need to confess of, or have any so-called skeletons in the closet, or hidden secrets, or hidden sins, or unconfessed sins, you need to give them up. You need to lay them out before God. Because if you don't, he's going to come out and lay them all in front of your eyes. The ones that you refuse to change. So, it's your choice. Isaiah 65, verse 25. And the wolf and the lamb, they shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the bullock. And the dust shall be in the serpent's meat. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, says the Lord. We will travel and explore without coming weary or tired. Isaiah 40:31. And by the way, we will travel on different planets too. Yes, there is life on other planets. Other stars. Every star out there has life in it, but we can't see it with the physical eye. You will be able to travel from planet to planet, exploring the universe. Isaiah 40, verse 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, and they shall mount up with wings as eagles, and they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. You will listen to God. We will listen to God. Zephaniah 3:7. I say, surely thou wilt fear me, thou wilt receive instruction, so their dwelling should not be cut off, and whosoever I punished them. But they rose early and corrupt all their doings. Excuse me. Zephaniah 3:17. Excuse me, I don't know how to. The Lord thy God in the midst of thee is mighty. He will save. He will rejoice over thee with joy. He will rest in his love. He will joy over thee with singing. Relies fondest ambitions. Psalms 37. Psalms 37 verses 3 and 4. Trust in the Lord and do good, so that thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Psalm 65:24. Psalm 65:2-4. I don't know why I keep. Alright, Psalms 55:2-4. O thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. Iniquities prevail against me. As for our transgressions, thou shalt purge them away. Great joy of all privilege. The greatest joy of all is the privilege of being like Jesus, traveling with him, seeing him face to face. 1 John 3:2. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Revelation 14:4. Revelation 14:4. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb. Whithersoever he goeth, these were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. Revelation 22:4. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. Revelation 21:3 says this, And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. The righteous will build their own houses and vineyards, gardens. We will eat and multiply our foods. We will build our own homes and houses in the way we want it. Gardens. John real quick. John 14, verses 1 through 3. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's houses are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you unto myself. And there where I am, there you may be also. Alright, let's just see if there's one more. That talks about the mansions. Hang on, I got a scripture behind that. John 14, 1 through 3. They will plant vineyards and eat the fruit from them. The Bible's plain. Real people do real things in heaven. They will thoroughly enjoy it. Isaiah 66, 21. There we go. Isaiah 66, 21. Verses 22. And will also take of them for the priests of the Isaiah 65:21-22. Okay. And I will also take of them for priests and for Levites, said the Lord. For as the new heavens and the new earth which I will make shall remain before me, says the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. Excuse me, I'm sorry. I don't know, I thought I wrote it down correctly. Excuse me for this. We will build homes. And I'm reading this. Isaiah 65:21-22. And they shall build houses and inhabit them. And they shall plant vineyards and eat the fruits of them. They shall not build, and other inhabitants, they shall not plant, and other eat. For as the days of the tree of the days of my people and my elect shall long enjoy the work of their hands. There you go. That's correct. Isaac, the homes build, you will build your own homes and build your own garden. You will find that in Isaiah 65, verses 21 through 22. Excuse me for the long delay. I guess I didn't write it down. Jesus will rule from Jerusalem. Zechariah 14. Zechariah 14, verses 4. And his feet shall stand in the day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east, and the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. In Zechariah 14, verses 8 through 10. It shall be in that day that living water shall go out from Jerusalem, half of them toward the former sea, and half of them toward the hinder sea. And summer and winter shall it be. And the Lord shall be kings over all the earth. And in that day shall there be one Lord, and his name one. And the land shall be turned as a plain from Geba to Rimmon, south of Jerusalem, and it shall be lived upon and inhabited in her place from Benjamin's gate unto the place of the first gate, unto the corner gate, and from the tower of Hanel unto the king's wine presses. And then 16 verses 16 through 17. Zechariah 14:16-17. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up from year to year to worship the King and the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. And it shall be that whoso will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. Who all is going to be there? 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17. I'll give you some examples, friends. Only the people who are right, who accepted Christ, whether they're family, friends, Old Testament saints, Old Testament prophets, New Testament saints and prophets, Millennium saints, Tribulation saints, people, all the saints that came out of the Tribulation, the Millennium period where God will reign for 1,000 years, the saints and prophets of the Old Testament and the New Testament, families and friends, all them people will go up there with us. And see, not everybody's going to. Heaven is not really made for people, but I tell you something. There's some going to be there, and it's the 144,000. But the rest of the people, the new heaven and the new earth will come here. Once we will pretty much be here on earth, the same earth, but without the evil and wicked. It'd be like this as it was in the beginning of time within the Garden of Eden, when the first God first created the Garden of Eden, the world as it was before, new life, everything. That's basically what it would be like. The kingdom of God, the new Jerusalem, will sit in Jerusalem here, and it will be the new Jerusalem, the city of God, which is the golden city, the streets of gold, which is found in Revelation 21 and 22 verses 1 through 10. That city of God will come, physically come down to earth. And then not everybody will go to heaven at one time. But those who was raptured up will go in first. And then when we come back after the evil was gone, destroyed, then the God comes back and reigns. He will create the new heaven and the new earth, and then that's where we'll be. But it'll be here in the planet, on this planet Earth. Just imagine the new heaven, new earth, basically Garden Eden, and how God first created the planet without evil. That's basically what it's going to look like. Everything's going to be perfect again. How to get to heaven? Only one way. And Jesus Christ said in John 14:6, said, "I am the truth, the way, the life." I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. First of all, and another way to get in heaven, first of all, you have to acknowledge you're a sinner and in your sins. You have to realize that you have to confess with your own mouth that first of all you're a sinner, and the sin has separated you from God. You have to testimony of your sins, which is first John 1:9. In other words, confess it. Confess your sin. You have to realize when Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, he paid for your sins. All paid in full. All the sins was placed on him once and for all. That he paid for your sins. When he died, you also have to confess that God sent his only begotten Son on the cross to be crucified. And he paid for your sins in full. The wages of sin is death, and Jesus paid for your sins and sins of the world. Place your trust in the Word of God, Jesus. Jesus said that he was the Word. John 1:1 and 1:14 says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. John 1:1, and John 1:14 says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So you know that the Bible is the Word, and Jesus is the Word. So whatever he spoke, you'll find in the Bible. You have the greatest gift right here. You have to place your trust in the Word of God and testimony that you have to believe that you're saved, and by the grace of God that you're saved and that you're a child of God. You have to also confess you're a child of God and that by grace you're saved. Ephesians 2:8, and that you're a child of God through Jesus Christ. Galatians 3:26. Confess and acknowledge your sins, 1 John 1:9, These are the way and steps to heaven and eternal life. And I assure you, Lord, I assure you all. Now, if you want to know about the kingdom of God, what it looks like, it's a city made out of pure gold. Streets of gold. There's no evil in it. It looks like a cube. And it's got descriptions in Revelation 21. Tells you what it looks like. And then Revelation 22, 1 through 10 tells you what it looks like. And what's in it. So brothers and sisters, there is a kingdom of God. I'm sure you hear it. It is real. It exists. And where is it at? It's in heaven. God's kingdom is in heaven. You also find that in Revelation 21. So anyone who sits there and tells you that the kingdom of God is not real, or they don't believe in it, you better tell them different, because there is a kingdom. And God wants all those righteous and all the good ones to join with Him. He does not wish to destroy us. He does not want us to be separated from Him. But yet sin has. So you have to, if you want to go into heaven, you want to be with God forever, you need to study the Word, repent of your sins, believe in Jesus Christ, give all your sins up, confess even your own confessed sins, follow those steps that I told you. I assure you, it'd be the best decision you ever made. I pray to see you one day in heaven or in the new kingdom. God bless.